out of themselves, humble themselves and pray.
Good evening, everybody. I hope everybody is having a fantastic week. It is good for us to be here because the Lord has ordained it. Before the creation of the world, He knew that you and I would be having this meeting on this particular day, and it's by the grace of God that He has allowed us to see another day. God bless you. So glad that everybody joined us today. So glad to see everybody. Today, my brother JLC, good to see you, my brother. Hope all is well with you. We're having an Alamo Showdown down here in Texas. Lisa Bates, good to see you. God bless you, my dear. Hope everything is fine in Illinois. I know that you guys are catching it down there also. Brother Howard, good to see you, my brother. Brother Marine Howard, good to see you. Hope you and the family is doing well. My man, Eric, God bless you there, Eric the welder. Good to see you, my brother. Hope all is well with you. And Sister Brittany, good to see you. God bless you, Brittany. Hope all is well with you. And good to see you. And my darling, Clever, good to see you, my dear. And I know things are well with you. You've been getting the proper rest. Good to see everybody today. And today we're going to be in a familiar text. Some of you are familiar with it. It's found over in Hebrews chapter 12. And we're going to actually read from verse 18. We're going to read more verses than we normally read. We're going to read from verse 18 down to verse 29. We normally don't read that many verses, but I want to read all of those verses for you today. For ye are not coming to the mountain that might be touched, and that burn with fire, nor unto blackness and darkness and tempest, and the sound of the trumpet and the voice of words, which voice they had heard and treated that the word should not be spoken to them any more. For they could not endure that which was commanded. And if so much as a beast touched the mountain, it shall be stoned or thrust through with a dart. And so terrible was the sight that Moses said, I exceedingly fear and quake. But ye are coming to a Mount Zion and unto the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, and to an innumerable company of angels, to the general assembly and the church of the firstborn, which are written in heaven, and to the God, the judge of all, and to the spirits of just men made perfect. And to Jesus, the mediator of the new covenant, and to the blood of sprinkling that speaketh better than things than that of Abel. See that ye refuse not him that speaketh, for if they escape not who refuse him that spake on earth, much more shall not we escape if we turn away from him that speaketh from heaven, whose voice then shook the earth. But now he had promised, saying, yet once more, I shake not the earth only, but also the heaven. And this word, yet once more, signifieth the removing of those things that are shaken, as of things that are made, that those things which cannot be shaken may remain. Wherefore we receive a kingdom, for which cannot be moved. Let us have grace, whereby we have served God acceptable with reverence and godly fear. For our God is a consuming fire. And we want to talk about, for the Lord, my God, is a consuming fire. I like to make it personal. I don't know about you, but I like to, my God is personal God. I said my God, because he may not be your God, but he's my God. For the Lord, my God, the Lord, my Jehovah, is a consuming fire. Now, people do not like to think of the Lord God as being a consuming fire. They like to talk about him being loving, him being merciful, him being kind, him being long-suffering, and he's all of that in a bag of chips. But we must understand that the Lord has standards that he will never compromise, not for me, not for you, not the Pope, not your granny, not your meemaw, none of that. He doesn't compromise, and he don't care if you agree with him. See, this is the thing we must understand about a holy God. He does not care if you agree with him. He's not looking for a debate team. The debate is over. Whatever the Lord says, that settles it. Whether you agree with it or not, it doesn't make a difference if you agree with it. It doesn't make a difference if your so-called bishop or apostle agrees with it. It doesn't make a difference if I agree with it. The Lord has said it. He sits in heaven. He does whatever he pleases, and he don't need anybody counseling him. Now, in our text, it speaks of two mountains, if you're familiar with this. One is called Mount Sinai. It's the place where the law was given. If you remember that story, Mount Sinai is where Moses received the Ten Commandments. Mount Zion, it speaks of grace, the law and grace. And when it says the Lord Jesus came full of grace and mercy, Mount Zion represents grace. Now, the mistake that those who focus on the law make is believing that they can keep the law. The law was never given because you thought you could keep it. That's the mistake that most people who read the Bible, they come to the notion that they can keep the law. I want to be clear. I want to clear it up. I want to clear your conscience. I want you to not have any deceptions in your spirit. No one, including Moses, has kept the law. The only person who's ever kept the law was the Lord Jesus Christ. So that should stop all mouths from thinking that they can get to heaven any other way. It is ridiculous. I like to keep repeating this because it's absurd. The law was a mirror for you to hold up to see all your blemishes. You know, when you look in the mirror shows you if you got something in your eye, you got something running down your nose. It shows you your flaws. The mirror is not meant to correct you. The mirror is meant for you to show you what flaws are. Now, looking in the mirror does not change your reflection whatsoever. You can wipe away, just say for instance, if you have some deformities in your face, looking in the mirror is not going to change that. You might go get an operation, it may change it temporarily. Eventually, you still will get wrinkles because the mirror cannot change that by looking in the mirror. The law is a mirror. Don't forget this, the law is a mirror and it's meant for you to look at it. You cannot accomplish the law. It's not meant that, but the Bible is very clear that nobody, there is not one who is righteous. No, not one. The law was given to show you how much you need Mount Zion. The law was given to show you how much you need grace. Now, some people take that grace a little bit too far, and they think that they can do anything because of grace. So ain't no need you focusing on you thinking you can keep the law. Now, the mistake that those who focus on grace makes is believing they can live any kind of way and grace will cover their raggedy lifestyle. See, you got the extreme on both. The people who got who think they're under the law, they think they're keeping the law. Oh, I don't sin, I keep the law. You're a liar. I don't care who you are a liar. Nobody is keeping the law, period. The law was never given that you was going to keep it. Now, that doesn't mean that you doesn't try to live by God's standards. It shows you that you need grace, but it also lets you strive while you're on this earth, strive toward being closer to him because he will teach you how to walk. And you can't learn how to walk unless you read his words. There is no, you're going to go through motions and you're going to fix it in your own mind. You're not smarter than God. This is his word. See, grace does cover a multitude of sins. But if you think you can live any kind of way because you say, I'm under grace, I'm not under Sinai, Mount Sinai. It doesn't work like that. The Lord at Mount Sinai instilled fear in the people, yet many still were very disobedient. Did you notice that? The scriptures always talk about the fear of the Lord. I'm scared of people who's not afraid of the Lord. I don't want to be around those people. They scare me. Not in a way that I'm scared, I'm shaking in my boots. It's that something's going to happen to them. Whenever I hear somebody using the Lord's name in vain and just being irrelevant towards the Lord, just thinking they can act and do anything, those type of people scare me. Because only a fool would say in his heart there is no God, and only a fool who thinks he can mock God. See, Mount Sinai, the Lord put some healthy fear in the people at Mount Sinai. It's impossible to worship the Lord without a healthy fear. Not true worship. You can play with the Lord and go to church and play church. You see all these people playing in church now? See, I'm scared of people who go to church and act any kind of way in church. If you're going to act like that, just stay at home. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Now, when we look at chapter 19 of Exodus, it ties into our text here in Hebrews chapter 12. In Exodus 19, you will notice that the Lord told Moses that when he descended on Mount Sinai, no one was permitted to touch the mountain. Did you get that? That's your homework assignment. Go read Exodus chapter 19. You're not holy enough to approach the Lord, period. And when I hear somebody saying they're going to get to heaven without Jesus, what they're saying is, I'm holy enough to get to heaven. Not Muhammad. All the other religions is fake. They're fraudulent. And I say it. It's not me judging it, but the Bible is judging it. They're phonies. They're frauds. You cannot get to heaven. Muhammad is not sinless. And the Muslims will tell you Muhammad is not sinless. Buddha is not sinless. How is a sinner going to help you get to heaven? The only way you can get to heaven is you need an atoning sacrifice that's sinless. It's absurd. This is an absurdity in and of it itself. See, most people don't understand the holiness of God. That's why they think they can approach the throne of God. See, God wanted to establish with Moses and all the people, you're not holy enough to approach me. I'm going to give you a law just to show you you're not holy enough. And you're going to break the commandments. Before Moses even came off the mountain, they had already broke the commandments. Sinai, the Lord told Moses, don't let anybody, don't let no animal, nothing touch the mountain. When I descend and my presence is up there, anybody touch this mountain, I'm going to kill them. They said, it's not the God I know. That's exactly right, because you don't know the God of the Bible. My God is consuming fire. When he says something, he means exactly what he says. He don't care if your man agrees with it. He means exactly what he says. This shows how far the distance is between. When God said, don't touch the mountain, don't let the animals touch the mountains, all he was doing is showing you the distance of the holiness of God and sinful humans. That's including you too, baby, with your cute self. Yes, all of you. Everybody who's listening, everybody who's not listening, all, what is it, 7 billion people on earth? All those and all the ones who's died before those too. The distance between a holy God and any human that's ever walked this earth is the earth and eternity. Is you can't even measure it. You can't be. I always find it fascinating when I hear a preacher telling me that they can be God, I'll turn you completely off. Whenever I hear somebody making a mockery of God, pretending as if, I think it was T.D. Jakes and Kenneth Copeland and Joyce Myers. I heard a clip from them the other day. They were saying that the Lord actually has breasts because he's male and female. See, this is the kind of blasphemy that I'm talking about, because this is a disrespect to a holy God. People don't really understand who God is. This is why he constantly told them, don't make any graven images on earth, because there's no one that you can liken unto me. No one. No one can compare to a holy God. It's no comparison. There is nothing or no one that you can compare to a holy God. Don't even think you can. Not your grandma, not your greasy granny, not any other bishop or anybody else. Now, when we go to our text today, it says, for ye are not come unto the mountain that might be touched and that burn with fire. That's Mount Sinai. Nor unto blackness and darkness and tempest, and the sound of a trumpet, and the voice of words which voice they had heard, entreated that the word should not be spoken to them anymore. When the Lord came down on this mountain, the thunder and lightning. See, most of you get scared. When y'all see a bad hurricane or a storm, it brings fear into people. If you ever seen the people on the ocean, and the ocean is that tempest wind, a bad storm comes up, it scares even the bravest of men. Moses and the people of God was here. The children of Israel was here. The Lord came down on this mountain. It says the whole mountain was quaking. The whole earth was shaking. Fire and everything else to put fear in you. And then the trumpets start blasting. Moses was shaking in his boots. And the people said to Moses, we don't want to get that close to that God because he's scary. My God is a consuming fire. They said it looks right scary. Tell what we're going to do, Moses. We're going to stay over here. We're going to stay at a distance from the Lord. And we'll let you go talk to him. Now, even though Moses was afraid, Moses approached God because he called Moses up. See, you're supposed to have a healthy fear of God, but you got to learn how to get close to him. No, you got to say, I want you to hide me in the shadow of your wings. It says that the sound of the trumpet and the voice of the words, which voice they that heard, entreated that the word should not be spoken to them anymore. They said, enough is all I can stand, and I can't stand no more. Don't speak to us anymore, Lord. Let Moses talk to us, because you're scaring us. For they could not endure that which was commanded. And if so much as a beast touched the mountain, it should be stoned. You say, I don't care. Nothing can touch the mountain. Not the beast, not you, no one. Or thrust through with a dart. And so terrible was the sight that Moses said, I exceedingly fear and quake. Moses' knees was knocking together when the Lord showed up. See, this is why I find it just insulting. When somebody said, I saw the Lord, the risen Lord himself, and we were just walking and talking. Are you kidding me? If you saw the risen Lord, if you saw God in his glory, you're going to be prostrate on your face. Tell me you just walking like it's happy-go-lucky or something. How arrogant. Now, this is a reference to Mount Sinai in chapter 19 of Exodus. Verses 10 and 11 of Exodus says, and the Lord said unto Moses, go unto the people and sanctify them today and tomorrow, and let them wash their clothes. It's time to take a bath. Wash your clothes. Now, technically, washing clothes really usually meant in the Old Testament, there's a new beginning. But put on some new, it's a new beginning here. And then it says in verse 11, and be ready against the third day. I always give that third day. It's very, very, Jesus rose on the third day. For the third day, the Lord will come down in the sight of all the people on Mount Sinai. Woo! Talk about, see, the washing of clothes represent a new beginning in scriptures. You remember in Genesis, when Jacob got ready to go back to Bethel? Now, you know Bethel means the house of God. It says in Genesis 35:2, then Jacob said unto his household and to all that were with him, put away the strange gods that are among you and be clean and change your garments. In other words, it's time to stop the idol worship and serve the only true God and the living God. Now, this is funny that Jacob would wait until the Lord says time to go to Bethel before he does. Why was Jacob permitting this? See, sometimes we become comfortable and we start permitting idolatry. You got to be on guard for idolatry all times. Because if you're doing all this unfamiliar spirits or, quote, familiar spirits, anything that's going to take your worship towards the true and living God, he's jealous about that. So some of you need to put away your idols and change the garments of your mind and wash away the filth of your idol worship and serve the only true God whose name is Jehovah. See, the Mount Sinai mindset wants to worship the Lord in only a certain place or a location. See, I call that the Mount Sinai mindset. We only can worship him right here. We get off into fleshly worship. No spiritual, really spiritual worship. See, David had a lot of problems, and David did some things, but he never got like Solomon. Solomon got way away. He allowed all kind of idolatry worship. David never did idolatry worship. He did some other things, but it was never idolatry. And he considered it as the best king Israel ever had. There's nothing wrong with a temple for worshiping the Lord. But remember what Stephen says in Acts chapter 7, before he was stoned by the people of Mount Sinai, because the people of Mount Sinai will stone you because they're fleshly. He said, howbeit the Most High dwelling not in temples made with hands, as saith the prophet, heaven is my throne and earth is my footstool. What house will ye build me, saith the Lord, or what is the place of my rest? Had not my hand made all these things, everything here the Lord made it. No, it did not explode by itself. Everything here right now, God made it, and he's going to be the one who take it out. Also, there is a problem with those who claim they are worshiping at Mount Zion, which they are not. While the grace of the Lord is a beautiful thing, they have used grace as a way to act and live any kind of way. That's not true grace. Because grace, if God has showed you grace, shouldn't you be thankful? Shouldn't you be grateful and show gratitude? You can normally tell when a person is not grateful towards what the Lord has done for them. That's why Romans chapter 6 says, neither yield ye your members instruments of to unrighteousness unto sin, but yield yourself unto God as those who are alive from the dead, and your members as instrument of righteousness unto God. For sin shall not have dominion over you, for ye are not under the law, but under grace. See, having dominion, that doesn't mean you're without sin, but sin does not have dominion over you. You ever get some people say, I just can't stop myself. Yeah, because you're living towards Mount Sinai. And when you're living towards Mount Sinai, you want to be disobedient, because the flesh has a way of doing its own thing. That's what flesh does. It wants to do its own thing. When the Lord Jesus Christ was talking to the Samaritan woman at the well, he said, but the hour cometh, and now he is, when the true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth, for the Father seeketh such to worship him. God is spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. Did you get that, what the Master says? The hour cometh, and now is, when true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. How you going to worship in truth if you don't know his word? In order to worship the Lord God in spirit and truth, you must be filled with his spirit. That's why Jesus says you must be born again. He said this is not up for debate. It's not an option. Now, how can you actually see what thus says the Lord if you're not born again? That's why when you read the Bible, it's going to mean nothing to you. It's a foreign language to you. Because unless you're born again, it becomes as gibberish. You can't speak his language if you're not filled with his spirit. There are not many ways to heaven. There is only one way, and that must come through the Lord Jesus Christ. Just remember that our God is a consuming fire. That means that our God is holy, holy, holy. That is a holiness without end. See, it doesn't mean holy to the third power. It technically means he's holy without end. You can't relate to that. You're a sinner. I'm a sinner. You can't really relate to a holy God because there is no shadow of turning in him. Quit acting like these people are on the same level with God Almighty. Quit acting like these other, quote, so-called religious is on the same level with Jesus Christ. They're not. The reason there must be a hell is there must be punishment for sin. Because if there is no hell, God is not just. To me, it's the most asinine thing when I hear like the Jehovah's Witnesses say, I don't believe in hell. It doesn't matter if you believe in hell. You may not believe fire is hot, but you will soon find out. Is that the Lord? See, the problem with people not believing in hell is they don't believe that the Lord can punish people who have done wrong. So all these people who do all this wrong on earth, they just die and nothing happens. They cease to exist. You think the Lord will ignore my sins? We think the Lord will ignore your sins? You must pay for your own sins, which you don't have the spiritual capital to do. So either you can pay for your sin, or you must have a mediator, which there is but one who is able to do that. His name is the Lord Jesus Christ. Nobody else can pay for your sins, period. See, this is why people have a misconception of what the gospel is. See, the gospel really is teaching that you need a savior. No other religious talks about this. The other religious says, do this, do that, and you may outweigh all your good against your bad or whatever. That ain't what the Bible says. The Bible says your good will never be good enough. The only way you get your good weighed is after you accept the Lord Jesus Christ. So the reason that he is the only way is because he's the only sacrifice that's been acceptable to God, because he's the only one without sin. Now our text says, starting with verse 22, but ye are come unto Mount Zion and unto the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, and to innumerable company of angels, to the general assembly and the church of the firstborn, which are written in heaven, and to God the judge of all, and to the spirits of just men made perfect, and to Jesus the mediator of the new covenant, and to the blood of sprinkling that speaketh better things than that of Abel. Abel had a good testimony, but his blood is nothing compared to the blood of Jesus. That's why when John the Baptist seen Jesus coming, he says, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. John the Baptist says all sacrifices can stop now, because those sacrifices could never satisfy God. They were temporary until the Lamb of God showed up. Mount Zion represents the city of God. In the city of God, the angels dwell there. In the city of God, the church of the saints who have passed away, they dwell there. In the city of God, there is also the saints of the Old Testament dwelling there. And of course, the living God, the maker and creator of heaven and earth, dwells there. But he is not limited to that particular location, because the heavens upon the heavens cannot contain him. How can he be in one place at one time? How can you contain God at one place at one time? It says there's no place you can escape the presence of the Lord. He's everywhere at the same time. You can't comprehend that. How is it that some of these so-called preachers are making themselves to be a God? You are limited to space and a certain location. God can be everywhere at the same time. He can be on Mars and Jupiter. He can be at the bottom of the ocean. He can be in hell all at the same time. How are you going to think that you can be God when you don't have the capacity to be every place at the same time? The heavens is full of his glory. And you know who else is there? In heaven, the city of God, the mediator who made it possible for all us to be there. He's the one who ushered in the new covenant. He's the one who can quench the consuming fire which the wrath of God is. God the Son paid the price for our sins by placing your faith and following he alone, we can be accepted by the God and Father. And we are sealed by God, the Holy Spirit. You want to arrive at Mount Zion, which is what Galatians chapter 4 is speaking of. See, Ishmael, whose mother was Hagar, in the text in Galatians chapter 4, they represent Mount Sinai. Ishmael and Hagar. Hagar's the mother. Ishmael's the son that Abraham and Sarah got together and was going to help out God. They represent the flesh. They represent Mount Sinai. But Isaac and Sarah represents Mount Zion. See, they are, Isaac is the son of promise. Sarah was way past the age of childbearing. Abraham was way past the time of producing, but God. Anytime you're having difficulties, all you have to do is put a but God there. Because whenever it's over here, God has a way to equalize whatever's over here. I know I'm talking to somebody. I say is that whenever you're going through a difficult situation, whenever you have a problem you can't fix, all you got to do is add it in but God. Because if God is for you, it don't matter who's against you. It doesn't matter. See, you will get worked up on what the world is doing and you hear wars and rumors of wars, and it'll get you worked up because you're taking your focus off the one who's able to do exceedingly and abundantly above anything you can ask. It ain't nothing my God can't do. See, I'm not worrying about who my enemies are because we got them outnumbered. I'm on God's team, and if I'm on God's team, I am in the majority every time. I don't care who else is on the other side. God of glory, God Almighty El Shaddai is on my side. I take that back. I'm on his side. Because if I'm on his side, if I'm following him, it doesn't matter what my enemies think. They can't touch me. As MC Hammer would say, can't touch this. They can't touch you if God Almighty is for you. That's a fact. Because if your enemies could have taken you out, they'd have taken you out already. The only reason you're still here is because you are a child of Mount Zion. You are under the grace of God Almighty. Now, I want to read Galatians chapter 4, starting at verse 21. It says, tell me, ye that desire to be under the law, do you not hear the law? For it is written that Abraham had two sons, the one by a bondmaid, the other by a freed woman. That's Hagar and Sarah. But he who was of the bondwoman was born after the flesh, but he of the free woman was by promise. Which things are an allegory, for these are the two covenants, the one from the Mount Sinai, which generate to bondage, which is Hagar. For this Hagar is Mount Sinai in Arabia, an answer to Jerusalem, which now is and is the bondage with her children. But Jerusalem, which is above, is free, which is the mother of us all. For it is written, rejoice, thou barren that bearest not. Break forth and cry, thou that travailest not. For the desolate had many more children than she which had a husband. Now we are brethren, as Isaac was, are the children of promise. But as then he that was born after the flesh persecuted him that was born after the spirit, even so it is now. Nevertheless, what saith the scripture? Cast out the bondwoman and her son, for the son of the bondwoman shall not be heir with the son of the free woman. So then, brethren, we are not the children of the bondwoman, but of the free. When we walk after the flesh, we are acting like the children of Hagar. And when we walk after the spirit, we are embracing the promises that the Lord made unto Abraham. Notice that the text says the one born after the flesh persecuted the one born after the spirit. Ishmael persecuted Isaac. That's what the flesh do. Just like your flesh will persecute you when you walk not after the spirit. That's what the flesh does. See, you have a war going on in your body. It's a constant war. And that war is going to be going on until you die. You got a spirit if you're born again, and you got a flesh. And the flesh is at war with the spirit. There is a war inside your body to do right or to do wrong. You feed your spirit, it suppresses the flesh. That's why Galatians chapter 5 says, this I say then, walk in the spirit, that ye will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the lust of the flesh against the spirit, and the spirit against the flesh. That's what, they're at war with one another. And you make no bones about it. You are at war inside your body. Now, when we look back at our text, it says, see that ye refuse not him that speak it. For if they escape not who refuse him that spake on earth, much more shall not we escape if we turn away from him that speak it from heaven. Can it be any clearer? See, we have a God who has spoken to us. Now, he's spoken through his word. Now, some of you don't want to read his word. Some of you think you're smarter than God, but I got news for you, baby. You're not. Nobody is smarter than God. No one. No. You cannot outdo God. He knows your thoughts from afar off. Matter of fact, the Lord God Almighty knew everything I was going to say this day before the creation of the world. How are you going to actually be able to fight with someone who knows your thoughts before you know your thoughts? He knows your thoughts before your grandma was born, before your great-granny was born. You cannot stomp the God of glory. There is nothing new under the sun that catches him by surprise. Do you not think that we was going to have a corrupt government over here in the United States that we have right now? He already knew this. Just like he brought all the other corrupt nations down, when they got too arrogant, God had to spank them. You go throughout history. The one thing about history is that nobody seems to learn from history. People think they can do any and everything, and they think they can get away with it. And then some people want you to pray for those evil people. I will not. I will not pray for evil people. No, I will not. I will absolutely not pray for evil people. If you think that they can do anything, Babylon had to get it. Egypt had to get some. Assyria had to get some. The Roman Empire had to get some. The Chinese Empire had to get some. And guess what? America going to get some too. UK done got some. France had to get some. The USSR had to get some. Germany had to get some. America going to get some too. Everybody keep that. Don't listen to all these little pundits that tell you, oh, America's always going to stand. They're gonna be. You can't do any and everything and think God going to let you keep getting away with it. We have assassinated over 60 million babies. We're giving operations to little children now. And you think that the God of glory, a holy God, is going to wink at this? We're allowing and promoting child pedophilia in this country. And you think God Almighty is going to wink at that? No, he's a consuming fire. Now, when we look back at our text, it says, see that ye refuse not him that speak it. For if they escape not who refuse him that speak it on earth, how much more? You think he's going to let you get away with it? God Almighty is speaking today through his word. That's how God is speaking. See, people say he ain't speaking. No. See, the scriptures are pregnant with wisdom. Problem is that people think they're smarter than God. You think God did not know how to preserve his word? Hebrews chapter 1 says, God, who in sultry times and in divers manner spake in times past unto the fathers by the prophets, had in these last days spoken to us by his Son, whom he had appointed heir of all things, by whom also he made the worlds. How can you possibly think there is another way to heaven if you ignore God's word? When it says he has spoken in these last days through his Son, remember what John chapter 1 says about the Lord Jesus Christ. It says, and the word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. The word was made flesh. You're telling me that his word changes? Jesus is the same today, tomorrow, and forevermore, is he not? It says that he is the word. Jesus is the word. So he doesn't change. So when you want to take some scripture and take it out of context, you're trying to take Jesus out of context. When the scripture says that the Lord Jesus is the only way, this is not only because he died for our sins to stop us from hell's fire. He did that. It also means you could never get to know God the Father without knowing and accepting his Son. That's absurd. That's absurd to think you can get to know God the Father and you're going to ignore God the Son. There are too many references that points to the Lord Jesus Christ in the Old Testament and the New Testament. Taking him out of the equation, thinking you're going to get to heaven, is laughable. The scripture makes no sense. if there's another way to heaven. Absolutely. Matter of fact, God is unjust and he's cruel. If there's another way to heaven, God is cruel for sending his son to die for your sins, and there's another way to heaven. You think God wouldn't know it was another way to heaven? He could have said, there's two ways to heaven. I'm going to let you beat and crucify my son and kill him, and then there's some other ways. How absurd is that? Think about how insulting that sounds. God Almighty, who knows all things, that means he has to know there's some other ways. So if there's some other ways, why would he allow Jesus to be spit on and beat to a pulp like that for your sins if there's another way? Just think about how insulting that sounds to a holy God. You're telling God you don't know what you're doing. Shut up, Lord. I'll show you that there is another way. Whenever I hear somebody says, no, I turn them off. I'm turning you completely off. There ain't no other way because you ain't holy enough to get to heaven. Stop the madness. You're saying you're sinless or somebody else is sinless. And one thing I like about these other religions, none of them are claiming to be sinless. This is the other thing I understand by some of these Christians who be going along with this madness. The Muslims don't think that Muhammad or nobody else in their religion is sinless. Buddhists and nobody else think, nobody is caught saying that their savior or their leader is sinless but the Christians. And some of these Christians want to backpedal on that. I'm emphatic about it. Ain't but one sinless one to walk this earth, and he's the only one that can get you into heaven. The scriptures makes no sense if there's another way to heaven. All of those who believe that there's another way will get to know our God is a consuming fire. Now, text goes on to say, whose voice then shook the earth. See, when the Lord speaks, see, everybody thinks that there's really a battle of good and evil. If the Lord wants to destroy Satan, he can do it like this. Whenever Jesus showed up, what did the demons do? They started trembling. Please don't destroy us before our time. There ain't a battle. If God wants to, God is doing everything for a reason. Believe me, if the devil ain't been already destroyed, there's a reason. Just like in order to get pure gold, it has to be fire in order to get pure gold. See, he's using the satanic forces to purify you. Our text goes on to say, whose voice then shook the earth, but now he had promised, saying, yet once more, I shake not the earth only, but also the heaven. And this word, yet once more, signified the removing of those things that are shaken as of things that are made, that those things which cannot be shaken may remain. Everything that you see on this earth, everything that you see in the universe, everything that you see that has matter will be destroyed. No amount of earth worshiping, tree hugging can stop this because my God is a consuming fire. Everything, you can enjoy your little material stuff. Guess what? It ain't coming to heaven with you. When somebody dies, there's never a U-Haul behind them. And if it is, the grave diggers will get it as soon as you bury them. You can bury them with all the gold and diamonds you want. You can bury them in an expensive car. It ain't going nowhere with them. I bet they ain't driving it to heaven or hell, whatever they going. None of that. You ain't taking none of that earthly stuff with you. Everything you can see, touch, and feel is not coming with you in the afterlife. Now, at Mount Sinai, the Lord shook the earth. And in the future, he will shake the very heavens. He ain't gonna just shake the earth. He gonna shake the very heavens. No one can fight against my God. It's not even up for debate. Not your government, not the World Health Organization, not the WEF, not the UN. None of these people are no match for God Almighty. There's a bunch of so-called leaders in history who thought they were a match for God Almighty. The God of glory sits in heaven. He laughs at these fools. There ain't no comparison. Your government, I don't care if it's the CIA, the FBI, there's no comparison for God Almighty. And they too one day are going to have to meet their maker, and they're going to find out that my God is a consuming fire. The only things that will remain will be those that he has made eternal. Nothing else remains. Remember when Jesus said, I'm going to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come you again and receive you unto myself. See, that won't be burnt up. See, that's the good news. The things that he prepared and the rewards that he gives you, no man can steal them away from you. You don't have to lock them up. You don't have to get an alarm system for those heavenly things because your heavenly rewards is guarded by the God the God and creator of all the universe. Matter is not or will not ever be eternal. This is why I don't understand the false premise of people talking about things exploding and being eternal. Nothing that has matter and substance that you can touch, see, or feel is eternal, period. Nobody can ever prove that they ever seen any eternal matter. It's absurdity. But everybody gets impressed with NASA or some so-called intellect with about a 5 PhDs, and they got money. They must be smart. I ain't impressed with it. Go walk on water. Go create something out of nothing. Can't impress me. You're a human. You're human just like I am. Once you get to know the true and living God, you'll stop being impressed with human beings. The Lord has left his word so that we can know how to walk. His word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my pathway, as the scriptures would say. How can you walk in the light when you do not know his word? How can you stop from falling if you don't use his word to guide your feet? Whenever someone say they do not need God's word in order to know him and his will, the scripture says you are a liar. You are a liar. See, that's why the closer you get to God, the less you get worked up on world situations. The further you get away from him, you can get shaved. You're like Chicken Little. You're running around like a chicken with your head chopped off. I see all these Christians posting stuff on social media platforms. They run around, oh my God, what are we going to do? I ain't going to do nothing because I'm not scared. The God I serve is in charge. He don't leave the throne. He don't vacate his throne for no one. I don't have to get scared of no world powers. I don't have to get scared of nobody threatening me. None of that. Because my God is a consuming fire. He's in charge. Period. I believe that with all my heart. You can't do nothing to me unless my God permits it. And if he permits it, the reason he permitted, either I did something or he want to show me something. So I ain't scared of you. I go burn him. I'm not scared of you. No, I'm not scared because my God is a consuming fire. He's in charge. Period. End of discussion. You got to understand. You got to get this in your spirit if you get nothing else. Quit being shooken up by the world system. Oh my God, what are you going to do in Texas? I'm not going to do nothing in Texas, because if God wants to take out the Biden administration and anybody else who's trying to do anything to his children, guess what? He'll do it. So no, I'm not scared. And I'm willing to fight for it too. I'm not scared of nothing. No, not nothing. The one I fear is God Almighty. That don't mean you go out and do stupid things because you don't fear anybody. I'm not going to go to certain environments just to get myself killed for stupidity, because God gives you wisdom too. But you're not going to get me worked up and everybody running around, oh my God, we're going to nothing. Because my God is in charge. I just got off the phone with him. I don't have to worry about a thing because he's in charge. All I got to do is stay close to him. He's in charge, period. I'm sleeping like a baby. No, I'm not worried. Am I worried about what? Who's in charge? Can somebody please tell me the time in history that God says, I vacated my throne and I've left the world system to those? Are you kidding me? I mean, are you kidding me? You better go read Job, the devil himself, and he's the one who's running these world leaders, these demons. The devil himself needed permission to go get Job. He couldn't touch Job. He said, I would do something to him, Lord. This is the devil. He said, I would do something to me. But you protect him. You got a hedge around him. When the Lord puts a hedge around you, the devil can't get to you. He needs a permission slip. He needs a permission slip from God Almighty. He can't touch you without a permission slip. That's a fact. Now, you may give him permission by doing any and everything and by trying to get out of the will of God, but he can't touch you. What are we going to do about all this stuff going on? Nothing. Did you pray about it? Mm-hmm. Do everything you can, but make sure prayer is your first line of defense. I was talking to Clever just before I went on the air, and I was telling her about the story of Elijah. He had a servant, and the whole city was surrounded. Ooh, they had him surrounded. Ooh, these tough, big military people were surrounding the man of God. They said, we're going to get him now. We're going to take him out. We're sick of him telling our secrets while we're in our private, because God was listening to their conversation, and he was going back and telling Elijah, this is what they're doing. And he would tell the king, and he said, wait a minute, something going on. Who's snitching here? They said, you got a prophet over here who the Lord talks to. They said, let's go get him then. Now, if he knew what you were saying in your secret chambers, do you not know, fools, he's going to see when you coming to try to get his people? So they surrounded the whole city. Big old great big bad army. They huffing and puffing, gonna blow your house down. All that stuff going on, you know. Because most of the time, what most people get scared is the roar of the lion. If you can ignore the roar of the lion, because if you get close by a lion and hear him roar, it can be frightening. But it didn't say the devil was a roaring lion. It said he goes about like a roaring lion. So roar, roar. Oh, yes, let me get scared with you. Well, let me show me what to be scared at. No, I'm not scared. Because if you remember the story, let's get back to Elijah. And they were surrounded, and all these people were surrounded. And Elijah's, his servants, oh, Lord, what are we going to do? They got us surrounded. And Elijah, very calmly, because he had been walking with the master, he says, Lord, would you please open this boy's eyes up and show him that they who are with us is more than they who are against us. That's a fact. And when he snatched the covers off the conscience mind of the servant, he saw all of these angels with drawn swords, chariots of fire, waiting to take out the enemy. If my enemy tried to attack me right now, guess what? I got angels all surround me. I believe it was Richard Smallwood who sung that song, Angels Watching Over Me. You cannot do anything to me. I got angels with swords drawn ready to take you out. There's a lot of people who tried to take me out. The Lord put that sword on them. So you got to understand all my help coming from the Lord. I'm clear about that. All my help comes from them. No, I ain't scared because there's chariots and flaming fire of angels guarding me constantly. So you got to understand where your help comes from. You got to stop getting upset. Your army is bigger than their army. I don't care how strong they got drones. So do the Lord got drones too. And his drones is better than their drones. One angel can take out millions and millions if he got the one so seen fit. So if you think you need a reason to be scared, no, no, no. He's a consuming fire, but you got to get on the right team. Yeah, I've been drafted in his army. I'm on his team now. Hebrews chapter 4 says, for he that is entered into his rest, he had ceased from his own works as God did from his. Let us labor, therefore, to enter into that rest, lest any man fall after the same example of unbelief. For the word of God is quick, it's powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to dividing asunder of soul and spirit, of joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. Show me something that can do something like that. Did you hear how sharp the word of God is? It'll cut you. I will cut you. It says the word of God is quick. It's powerful. It's sharper than a two-edged sword. Watch this. Dividing asunder soul and spirit. Do you know anything else, any other book you can read that proclaiming that it can divide soul and spirit, joints and marrow? Is a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of the heart. See, you can fool some of the people some of the time, probably can fool most of the people most of the time, but you can't fool God none of the time. See, this is why you got to understand the word of God. It disciples through lies. When somebody shows me something and I know it contradicts the word of God, I don't got to read nothing else you said. I already know you're lying. I don't care what you say. You're lying because it contradicts the word of God. I don't have to read a philosophy book to figure this out. You just said something that contradicts the word of God, and now I know you're a liar. Do not come to me with that. Block all that. I don't care if it's your bishop, the pope, or whoever else. When somebody tries to get you to go against what the word of God says, I'm not arguing with you. I don't argue with people like that no more. I used to get a thrill out of arguing. I don't waste my time. I said, well, believe what you want to believe. We're going to see, because my God is a consuming fire. Now today, I say unto you that you should cease from your works and place your faith in his finished work and start doing his work that he has assigned to you. He's assigned all y'all different work. Everybody has a gift. There ain't no such thing as nobody has no gift. Some people may have more gifts than others, but everybody has a gift. God has instilled some gifts in you. Now, if you don't use your gift, you may lose it. You may lose it for not using it. Now, listen to what the master says over in Matthew chapter 7. Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven. Ooh, that don't sound like the Jesus I know. He sounds so unleavened. You don't know the Jesus of the Bible. Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father, which is in heaven. Many will say unto me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name? I'm a prophet. How many people run around saying they're a prophet right now, but they keep getting it wrong? I mean, this is to me the most outrageous thing. I'm a prophet, but I keep lying that the Lord told me something, but the Lord didn't tell me because it didn't come to pass, or I was calling a lie, but I'm a prophet. You're not a prophet. You're a liar. And then will I profess unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me, ye workers of iniquity. To me, that's one of the scariest scriptures in the Bible. Here you are. I served the Lord all my life. I went to such and such church. I'm a bishop, something. I know bishop such and such. My granddaddy built this and stuff. The Lord don't care nothing about all that. You ain't even a true. You got to be a true worshiper. And he says they will confess them. He says the Lord will say to them after they says, we did all these. We cast out devils in your name. We did many wonderful works. And Jesus will look at them and says, I never knew you. Depart from me, ye thy work iniquity. Therefore, whosoever heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them, I will liken him unto a wise man, which built his house upon a rock. And the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat upon the house, and it fell not. What? For it was founded upon the rock. Who's the rock? Jesus is the rock. And the builders have rejected the chief cornerstone. How are you going to get to heaven without the chief cornerstone? See, you're building your house on quicksand. You're building your house on mud. And that mud is not going to stand unless you're placing faith in the finished work of Jesus Christ. You're not good enough to get to heaven. Your grandma ain't good enough to get to heaven. Neither is your fake bishop. Everyone that heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them not should be likened unto a foolish man which built his house upon sand. And the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat upon the house, and it fell, and great was the fall of it. What you say? The fall was great because they built their house on quicksand. Building your house on there's another way to heaven is building your house on quicksand. Notice it says you need to hear his word in order to do his word. Did you get that part? Did you miss that part? You need to hear his word in order to do his word. How are you going to say, like, if somebody said, I want to be a scientist. No, I'm saying an astronaut. No, I'm not saying that because that may be something else. Let's say you want to be an architect, but you never go to school to be an architect. You know nothing about architect. You don't study the book of architecture. You want to be, just Eric likes to be a welder. Just say Eric never went to welding school. Eric wants to be a welder, but Eric never tried to practice welding. He ain't going to be no welder. You got to go practice in order to be a welder. If you want to be a doctor, you got to go to school and learn some about medicine. You got to learn how to do operations and what makes the body function. Here you are saying you want to be a child of God, but you say, I'm not going to ever read his word. Child, please. Child, please. How can you be planted on solid ground when you don't know his word? And how can his word, you know his word without hearing his word? How can you possibly say you can follow after the Lord Jesus when you never hear or read his word? John chapter 10 says, my sheep hear my voice. Did you get the part here? Here, knock, knock, knock. Knock, knock, my sheep hear my voice. I know them and they follow me. Who do they follow? Well, they follow somebody else who may know a way. No, that's not what he says. My sheep hear my voice and I know them and they follow me. They don't follow five different other ways to get there. And I give unto them eternal life. Nobody else can give you eternal life. Show me any other so-called church religion or anybody else that promise you eternal life. The Bible is the only book that promises eternal life. Go read the Quran. It doesn't promise eternal life. It says if you blow yourself up or do such and such right there, you get 77 virgin. That's still not promising eternal life. That ain't even a promise. That's absurdity in and of itself, if you ask me. I give them eternal life. There ain't but one who can give eternal life. And they shall never perish. Neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. This world that we live in will be destroyed by fire. The Lord himself will destroy it. When we say the Lord is a consuming fire, it means that the Lord has standards. Just because we say we are under grace, some think that means the Lord will allow them to live any kind of way. He will not. He will not do it. And while it is true that we are under grace, that does not mean the Lord allows you to live any kind of way. We all can get better. We all can confess our sins daily. But when we start just wagging our finger and sticking our finger in God's face thinking that we can do any and everything and there is no consequences, you're saying that God, you ain't really holy. The Lord God is holy, and that means he must require us to live a life that is holy. That does not mean you will become perfect. See, there's a difference between being perfect and living holy while you are here. But that does not mean you can call sin something else and expect the Lord to conform to your ways. Some people think that their struggles will cause the Lord to redefine words, but it ain't so. Well, I'm really struggling, so I think that I'm going to call it not a sin anymore. That ain't it. I do believe that most people who go to church and those who say they believe in God and don't attend church have no sense of the Lord's holiness. That's one of the problems of the churches. That's why people can play with the Lord. When somebody starts playing with the Lord, I don't want to talk to them more, because you playing with the dangerous stuff right here. The Lord ain't your toy. He ain't to be played with. Anybody who's thinking that some of the stuff that you see going on in church right now is an outrage, because they don't have no sense of the Lord God's holiness. Because we see people going to a place of worship and acting any kind of way. I won't call most places worship centers or God's house of worship, because he's not really welcome in their particular facility. It's a place of worship, but they're not really worshiping the Lord. Most preachers or so-called bishops or the apostles or even the Pope will say things about the Lord that he has never said about himself. And once you decide to play fast and loose with his word, he will give you over to yourself, and you will find out that my God is a consuming fire. See, the worst thing can happen to you or I is that the Lord just hand you over to you. That's the most scariest thing, because we understand when you see serial killers or child molesters or whatever, you think they got there overnight. See, these are the people who the Lord just handed over to themselves. I mean, once he hands you over to yourself, you become reprobate. And all of a sudden, nothing is bad enough that you can do. Have you paid attention to Hollywood? Have you paid attention to how sick these people are, the sick things they do? That's the Lord giving them over to themselves. That's called a reprobate mind. He says, okay, you like doing this? I'm giving you a chance to repent. You don't want to repent? Here you are. I'll just hand you over to yourself, and I'll take my hand and my grace off of you. And you see people doing any and everything. Now, the phrase is found, that phrase that God is consuming fire, is found in Deuteronomy chapter 4. And this is when the Lord made a covenant with the children of Israel. When Moses was telling the people that he was not going into the promised land with them, he gave this particular sermon to them. He says, take heed unto yourself, lest ye forget the covenant of the Lord your God, which he made with you, and make you a graven image, or the likeness of anything which the Lord thy God had forbidding thee. He's giving them a warning. Don't do it. Don't make any image. Don't be worshiping anything that you can see. For the Lord thy God is a consuming fire, even a jealous God. When thou shalt beget children and children's children, and ye shall have remained long in the land, and shall corrupt yourselves and make a graven image or the likeness of anything, and shall do evil in the sight of the Lord thy God to provoke him to anger, I call heaven and earth to witness against you this day. This is Moses telling the people, you're going to be hard-headed, you're going to be disobedient, and the God who's a consuming fire is going to punish you. He says, that ye shall soon utterly perish from off the land whereunto ye have over Jordan to possess it. Ye shall not prolong your days upon it, but shall utterly be destroyed. And the Lord shall scatter you among the nations, and ye shall be left few in number among the heathen, whither the Lord shall lead you. And there ye shall serve gods, the works of men's hands, wood and stone, which neither see nor hear, nor eat nor smell. But if from thence thou shalt seek the Lord thy God, thou shalt find him, if thou seek him with all thine heart, with all thy soul. When thou art in tribulation, and all these things are come upon thee, even in the latter days, if thou turn unto the Lord thy God, and shall be obedient to his voice. See, this is the thing. God always makes promises. And then when somebody was, I don't know how the Lord can allow this, you brought it upon yourself. Don't start trying to blame the Lord for people doing everything else. See, people want to do everything else, and then when the Lord takes his grace away and starts the punishment, all of a sudden they say, well, God is not fair. Hold on a minute. He gave you thousands and thousands of opportunities to repent, but you didn't want to do it. Don't allow anyone to deceive you that there is no hell. Just like there is a heaven, be sure there is also a hell's fire. And the only one that can keep you out of eternal fire is the Lord Jesus Christ. If your so-called religion does not start with a healthy fear of the Lord, then you don't have true religion, and you are on your way to hell also. Notice in our text, it says, even Moses, the man of God, said, I exceedingly fear and quake. Healthy fear of the Lord. The Lord Jesus says in Luke 12:49, I am come to send fire on the earth. And what will I say if it be already kindled? Did you hear that? They said, well, I don't remember Jesus saying that. Yeah, Luke 12:49. I am come to send fire on the earth. The Lord Jesus came to bring judgment on the world. Remember that the Master says in John 9, for judgment I am coming to the world, that they which see not might see, and they which see might be made blind. And some of the Pharisees which were with him heard these words and said unto him, are we blind also? Jesus said unto them, if you were blind, ye should have no sin. But now ye say, we see, therefore your sin remaineth. You should seek after the Lord while he is showing and extending mercy toward you. Understand that the Lord is a jealous God, and he demands your true worship because he alone is holy. In closing, I want to read something from the Apostle Peter. Now, this is found in 2 Peter chapter 3. The little book of Jude alludes to say some of the same thing. That's why some people believe that Jude actually got his particular text from 2 Peter, or from Peter's telling of the story. Now, 2 Peter chapter 3 says, but the heavens and the earth, which are now by the same word, are kept in store, reserved unto fire against the day of judgment, perdition and of ungodly men. But beloved, be not ignorant of this one thing, that one day is with the Lord as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years as one day. The Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but is long-suffering to usward, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. But the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in which the heavens shall pass away with a great noise, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat, and the earth also and the works that are therein shall be burned up. Seeing then that all these things shall be dissolved, what manner of person ought ye to be in holy conversation and godliness, looking for and hastening unto the coming of the day of God, wherein the heavens, being on fire, shall be dissolved, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat. Nevertheless, we are, according to his promise, look for a new heavens and a new earth, wherein dwell righteousness. Wherefore, beloved, seeing that ye look for such things, be diligent that ye may be found of him in peace, without spot and blameless. Be not deceived. One day the Lord Jesus is coming back, and he's coming as a consuming fire. He's coming for judgment. Now, you got two options. Option number one is you're good enough to get to heaven. You're going to make it there all by yourself, or you're going to depend on some other sinner, whether he be a religious sinner in history or a religious sinner today. You're depending on them to tell you that there's another way to heaven. Or you think you're good enough, or you think that your lineage of you is some kind of blue blood, that you can get to heaven on your own merit. Now, that's option number one, and that's a complete failure, because Isaiah says your best works is filthy rags. Now, door number two, or option number two, which is technically your only passport into heaven, is accepting the finished work of the Lord Jesus Christ, understanding that he came and paid the price for our sins, which we could never pay that price. We can never repay him. So now we ought to be grateful and try to live a life that's pleasing unto him because of what he's done for us. That's technically your only option. Now, if you go with option number one, you will find out that my God is a consuming fire. If you go with option number two, you will have entered Mount Zion. And in Mount Zion, the holy angels will be there. The saints of old will be there. The church will be there. And the Lord Jesus Christ will be in that new city of God. Now, I don't know about you, but that city sounds a whole lot more attractive than this other foolishness that we've been running around pretending that we got to know the one. You cannot get to know the one if you don't know his word. Now, the better, the closer you get to him, you will understand how holy he really are, how holy he really is, and how sinful you really are. You notice everybody in the Bible, the closer they got to God, the more they understand that they were sinners. Paul got closer to God. He says, I'm not worthy to be called an apostle. Moses understood this. Elijah understood this. Isaiah the prophet understood this. All of the disciples understood this. Whenever you see somebody acting as if their righteousness is good enough to get to heaven, you ought to just run to the hills somewhere else because this person is so dangerous. Nobody gets to heaven without the blood of Jesus Christ. And the blood of Jesus will never lose its power. Let us pray. Father, we thank you. Thank you for another day. We thank you for your word. We pray for those who are listening to our voices. We pray that you will strengthen their hearts and their minds, sanctify our hearts and minds, and give us the strength to understand who you are. Give us, increase our faith so that we may not trust in ourselves nor trust in any government or any political leader. That we will place our full trust in you, the only one who's able to deliver us. We thank you for your son, Jesus Christ, who came and died. He lived the perfect life. He died for our sins because he knew no sins. Thank you that he was raised on the third day and he's in glory now making intercessions for us. We pray for those who have not accepted Jesus as Lord and Savior. We pray, Lord, that you would trust and give them the wisdom and open up their eyes. Open up their eyes so that they may see that you are the only way that they will possibly see heaven. It is in Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen and amen. God bless you guys and God keep your hope that we said something that may be helpful to you. I hope we didn't offend anybody. If we did, I think you can get over it. that's what God does. Sometimes he allows people to do certain things until he says, enough is enough. And then he takes them out. That's what he does. God bless you. God keep you. Stay strong and understand. Don't let them get you worked up because my God is still in charge. He has not vacated his throne.